And down here at the bottom left-hand corner on Daybreak, we have our Red Terran player. Teamless at the moment, still a champion of a major IPL event. It is alive. It's alive. Here at the top right-hand corner, we have his opponent from the team Evil Geniuses, the Blue Terran player. It is Puma. And I love seeing these two guys going at it. It's going to make for fun, mixed up, unconventional TVTs. Although, honestly, TVT has been a matchup for a while that's it's actually not been all that stagnant in comparison to a lot of the matchups that are out there. It fell out of being just a straight-up battle of Marine Tank and let's hope to expand and get from there. And you see a lot of varied compositions, a lot of strong early game aggression.
Yeah. I think we're going to be seeing a ton of that, both of these players. As you, we were talking about this, actually, when we got started with the broadcast, about how both of our Terran players today are characterized by aggression. Alive, I think, likes his Marines a little bit more. Puma is more, let me just try using anything and everything that I can get my hands on that you're not going to expect. So
yeah.
Maybe we're going to see more ground-based attacks out of Alive and, you know, over the extenuated series. I mean, this is a great map for Banshee, so it's entirely possible we can see both players open with some sky play, but
Alive earlier today actually had a magnificent matchup. Puma had a magnificent matchup against Liquid Hero earlier on, where Puma tried a very strong two-base push on Ohana, and Hero was able to hold it just by the skin of his teeth. There's a great play. Then we saw that, you know, in the second game, Puma tried some more aggression. Hero wasn't able to take it, and it ended up turning into this crazy base trade with DTs and Ravens. It came down to, a Raven not getting picked off right in the very end. It was very cool stuff.
That's awesome. I assume Jay Morrow and Nathan casted those?
Yeah. Yes, cool. I did.
I was casting Shoot Mania this morning. Unfortunately, missed those games, but I had a lot of fun casting Shoot Mania, man.
You did a great job casting Shoot Mania.
It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Game's pretty action-packed. I was comparing it to basically casting StarCraft Battles the entire time.
Yeah.
With, like, slight lulls, you know, where the players, like, back off from each other, and then they fight again.
Right.
It was just lots and lots of, like, your play-by-play with analytics a lot based on positioning. It was pretty cool.
Oh, and it looks like Alive did actually get the first hit here, so unless another SCV comes up, and it looks like it is... Puma's going to lose that SCV. Oh, this is going to come down right to the end. Oh, the worker versus worker battle. The most exciting of all battles. And Alive has reigned victorious.
He needs to fall back, though. This worker will make quick scrap of that SCV. Now he's going to go check for any proxy barracks, which is actually really smart. If you're already halfway there, like, might as well check.
So. And it was a very, very good scout from Alive, too. He saw that super early factory that you only get by going gas first, so he knows exactly what his opponent's up to, and he's decided to switch things up by going into double refinery afterwards. So whereas this looks like it could just be, you know, a conventional Marine Hellion drop to begin things for Puma, Alive says, all right, well, you went for a lot of gas there. Now I'm going to flip it on its head. We could see Cloak Banshees.
Yeah, it's so perfect. The one thing that Alive didn't actually see, though, is the lack of a second gas out of Puma, which is going to make a big difference here, because Alive could go for Viking Siege Tank, which is very strong versus gas first openings.
Yeah.
But it's not going to be helpful versus a gas first that is not followed up with a quick second gas. What Puma's likely going for here is just a super fast Banshee and then a quick command center. Like, we should see a command center, like, he's going to be dropping it any second. Cool. And Alive may overreact to defending here.
Yeah, definitely. I think you're definitely right. So Puma is certainly going to have that mineral count, as we talked about just a second ago. Alive, on the other hand, is doing something a little bit different. He did put down that reactored barracks, so he's actually going to have a source for all of his money to go to. If he continues to make units out of this factory, too, we could see a strong one-base play. We'll certainly find out what that's
that
going to be in a bit.
Yeah, that might be what he's forced into here. If he makes a tech lab on that factory, he's committed. That's completely what I'm watching for right now. If he makes that tech lab, this game will end quickly.
Yes.
Because Puma, he has made the Banshee. He's actually started Cloak behind this, which I find very interesting. Excuse me. That's actually Alive. Alive is starting Cloak here.
Yes. So starting with that Cloak, he did have a lot of gas built up. Don't forget.
And he went double refinery.
Yeah. So we knew it was certainly a possibility, and it is going to be a reality, actually, as he gets in there. Now, of course, no tech lab on the starport. For Puma, no engineering bay down. He does have the double command centers, of course. But that's always, you always watch right at the very end, is that Banshee's going up. Oh, is he going to mule or is he going to save a scan? And if he doesn't save a scan, he could be in a lot of trouble.
Well, he's going to need it really, really bad. Curious to see. So Puma has started a very fast third command center here, which first is going to allow him to make up any losses that he sustains here versus Alive's cloaked Banshee.
Yes.
The Command Center's not really going to be done in time. The scans are a factor from the third CC, so we'll be keeping an eye on those other two. But I'm also, there it is. Puma starts the Viking right on time, Kevin, for when a Viking can, or when a Banshee can actually arrive on Daybreak without a gas first. So Puma assumes his opponent did not go gas first. He says, okay, if you open with a barracks first, right now is about when the Banshee's going to start up. And look at this Viking. It's 3/4 of the way down. The timing here is immaculate out of Puma.
And here comes Alive. He's still going to snag some kills. There's not enough energy on that orbital command. This orbital command's not done yet for another 15 seconds. So few workers killed. Things pulled out of position. Marauder may even die in the process. Very nice work here, I have to say.
He can sustain these losses, but what may kill him is this follow-up attack that we can see out of Alive, because Alive went for a very late command center. It's only about halfway done at this time, and Puma opted for a fast third, which Alive now sees. He's got lots of Marines, lots of Hellions. If he can keep this Banshee alive, which no, it's going to run out of energy and probably be picked off here, but I don't think he can make it home. But you see these forces gathering outside the natural right now of Puma. And Alive can do some serious damage with those units.
And look at this, Alive's running right back in to do more damage and pick off these missile turrets. And he's killing Marines the whole process. Because he's actually, you see, this is a little bit of a tell when you kill, when you're prioritizing those attack units. Because usually you're like, I just want to kill the economy. You have so many bases right now, I got to make sure that my next couple of bases have as many SUVs as you do. But picking off those units means there may be a follow-up to this and he wants to take out the DPS from his opponent's army.
It's so incredibly smart out of Alive, though. Because he knows that he doesn't have enough units to really kill Puma because Puma has that bunker in position. So
yeah.
Instead, he, you know, he's got his Marines, he's got his aliens. I expect him to come in here for the poke, but 17 workers, jeez.
Dude, yeah, that was really effective. 17 workers. Puma is, you see now, Alive's got his second base done and actually going for a third at the same time with coming in for another Banshee. He is in a magnificent spot.
You just pulled it up, Kevin. 18 to 33 workers, and Alive is also on 3 command center now.
Yeah, that's right. So, I mean, there's no disadvantage for him whatsoever. He's ahead of his opponent in tech as well. This is just devastating for Puma, and he's losing more workers.
It's pretty crazy, man, because Puma seemed to be pretty on top of the build that Alive was going for. I mean, he made that Viking at the perfect moment in order to deal with that Banshee, but he just didn't have anything to deal with Cloak. He didn't have an engineering bay. He had to drop it, and since then, 3 Banshees have come in and down a lot of kills.
Man, and Puma doesn't have control of the map right now. So let's say he's like gut reaction. Ah, okay, I'm too frustrated. I've just lost too much stuff. I have to move out. Oh, okay, never mind. Alive did pull away for a second. Now starting to make his way back up. He was actually in these gas vents, and had Puma decided to run things up, he would actually have been obliterated by all the units that were sitting inside.
Yeah, that would have been game over if Puma had tried to move anything out on the map. But as of now, Alive's actually going to pull back. It looks like he's going to go for quick stim, combat shield, siege tech. I mean, honestly, what I expect to see here out of Alive is once these upgrades finish, he pushes across the map, sets up a hard contain on Puma, and I'll be very impressed if Puma's able to break that contain.
All right, well, these Vikings have served their purpose now. They're patrolling back and forth, making sure no drops are going to hit him, because if anything else gets back in and does more economic damage to Puma, I mean, that's just curtains
that's
right there.
Yep.
As it stands, even, Alive is in a magnificent position, now up to 46 workers, significantly stronger army than his opponent. Both are adding on tanks at the same time, yes, but Alive's got the bio forces to back that up.
Yeah, he does. He's got quite a number of all sorts of forces. Tanks are on the field now as well for Alive. His siege tech is completed. He's also starting 1-1. The amount of tech that Alive is going to have here on Puma is going to be astounding. I mean, he's 1-1, yeah. Combat shield, stim. None of these are things that Puma has. Actually, stim. He does have stim.
Yeah,
he has to research that first. And now he's going to start combat shields. So it's going to be done so late.
That's right. But nothing coming out of this engineering bay. And, you know, more importantly is going to be the fact that he has those 1-1 upgrades. And Alive, look, being so smart, putting a supply depot here on the top left-hand corner, going to detect drops, going to be able to pick up on when he can actually safely take a fourth. That does so much for him in this game.
Yeah, it really does. You think about, you know, you put overlords over on the corner and such, and they're just as good as dead if your opponent spots it with a dropship as a supply depot is. It's really not any difference, except that it's a little more difficult, you know, to do as a Terran player because you have to send the SCV up there and then set it home. But
yeah, it takes time.
It's smart play, though.
But here's the thing, you know, Alive is in a magnificent position. Now, this is TVT, though, and this is obviously going to turn into Marine Tank TVT. So there is always a potential that Alive gets a little bit too ambitious, runs in there with some units, gets things killed really cost-efficiently by Puma, and he's able to stabilize, take his official third base, which he should be kind of trying to take pretty soon, and stabilizes and moves out from there on out. but that's unlikely given the way that Alive usually controls his units.
I agree. His control's really, really good. But that is the only way he could really end up in a terrible position here. Puma, it's too late at this point to do like a double expand or anything because Alive is getting ready to push across the map in the near future, in all likelihood. I would expect that out of him. And this is probably the squadron of Marines that's going to precede the army.
Yeah, let's take a look at the overall army count. 44 Marines to 14. And never mind the fact that they already have 1-1. Armory's about to finish up, and they're going to be 2-2 here in just a bit.
His resources are so perfectly timed here. I mean, Armory is going to be done in like 3, 2, 1. There goes the Armory. Look at the resources.
2-2. Yep. Boom.
Perfect.
Just instantly.
He had 30 extra gas. The timing here is immaculate for Alive.
Dude, he actually had no difference. How did he get both those upgrades so quick? Like, he had both the hockeys ready and just, like, jabbed him at the exact same time.
Does he have the engineering? So he has the engineering. Actually, grab his units. I'll show you. It's pretty cool. So he's got both engineering bays on 7. If you select both and hit EA... Yeah. You can just roll your fingers.
Yeah. But I mean, usually you see a tiny perceptible difference between the two. But usually it's like just a quarter of a second ahead one of them is. But no.
I just want to illustrate it because you brought it up, man. And it's impressive. It really is. When you see that, you're like, that player has their engineering base hotkeyed. Look at Puma. Does Puma?
Yeah.
Well, he's only got one engineering base, so it doesn't really count.
Unfortunately. And he's supply blocked, and there's an enormous army moving across the map for Alive. So Alive's been really far ahead in this game. It's the onus is on him to throw this away. That's how Puma gets back into this. If he positions his units poorly, if he doesn't attack in the right spot, if he throws his units into these all of these... Ooh, losing a little bit of life on these medevacs here. If he throws these into siege tanks, that's the only way that it'll happen.
Okay, so you need to take out these destructible debris, stutter step up the ramp, and game one. But he has to do it now. He has to do it right now. And tanks are staging, and that's it. Opportunity missed.
That's right. But now the tanks are actually split up, so Alive can't actually just bull rush his way through one of these attack paths. Whoa, what
that
is Poom?
Poom
is trying to pull some units back into these siege tanks, but he doesn't have enough medevacs to heal up those units.
Well, I think he saw Alive pull back with the Marines, and the siege tanks were actually too close.
Yeah.
But and Puma thought he could pick off the siege tanks. It was a clever move, but it didn't work out, of course, because Alive came down with the siege tanks, so the Marines could just trap the Marines. But it was a clever attempt.
Well, Alive is going to try and duck his way into the main here, but there he is.
Medevac, don't give up.
Yeah, no, that medevac's just going to go for it. Doesn't get all of his units out, but that's still enough Marines to start forcing some units back home. Second medevac almost gets killed, and Alive better do something with his army because Puma's actually going to clean this up.
That's a very cost-inefficient trade, but he may have bought himself positioning. Marines coming in right now will pick off. He needs to target fire the siege tanks here. SCVs are dead. Forces the lift on the third. 50 supply advantage at this time for Alive. And here's the contain that Alive needed. Now he can hold this third hostage, and he can just starve out Puma. Puma could try to flank the army here, but he's got a nice group of Marines and a tank as well that will be able to hold down kind of the flanking position. And if Puma fully commits to this, Alive will move into the natural.
Okay, that was big. That was a lot of units dead, actually. So there is a bit of a counterattack that's already happening. Alive is just going to play cautious and pulls his SCVs away. He's got the rest of his units coming through the front, so that's certainly going to be good for him, and he will be able to clean that up. Medevac going to head towards the top, but you're right. Alive's in perfect position now. So, like we said before, you never want to call opponents out immediately. Yes, there is the possibility that Puma wins a miracle engagement, counterattacks, and kills two bases, but at this stage, it's just so unlikely. The planetary fortress is almost done. His bases are bunkered up. And look at that. That was the vast majority of Puma's forces, and he's only barely going to kill these siege tanks. He hasn't touched this force off to the side, nor has he touched the reinforcements that are coming up.
That was cute, though. He got a couple of Marines in there. He's going to manage to clean it up, but there it is. GG out of Puma, guys, as he realized I have no chance to take back that base.
Yeah, that's right. So game number one goes to Alive, the former Fnatic and TSL player, and he's sitting pretty now, just one game away from making it out to IPL6.
Sitting pretty.
Yeah.
Alive's always sitting pretty.
Yeah. Are you calling
cool
him
hair.
Pretty?
He's got good hair. I wish I had hair like a lot of these guys. Really.
Alive's pretty awesome. He's also very... while he can project kind of a big personality at times online and stuff like that, he's very like, oh yeah, hey. How's it going? I'm really good at StarCraft, and then crushes you.
Yeah.
So.